everybody cleaned up their act, and it was time to make some new music, and there was no way we were gonna do it at home. We needed to go away and wake up and eat, live, and breathe music, not, you know, well, I'll get to the studio, you know, like I gotta take my girlfriend to the hair salon, and then I gotta take helicopter flying lessons, and oh yeah, you know, shit, I'm not gonna make it today, guys. Like, we're like, we're going to Vancouver, we're moving, we brought our motorcycles, we brought all of our, you know, pinball machines, games, toys, and we just set up shop, and we're like, we're gonna wake up and make music until we can't see straight, go to sleep, do the same thing over it tomorrow for 6 months.
Bands keep doing, they don't stop.
You know, it worked. You know, it absolutely worked. And, you know, everybody was sober, everybody had clarity. You know, we'd go to work every day and, you know, whistle blow, we'd go back, you know, back to our apartments and hotel rooms and things, and it was a really good, cool, creative time for Motley.
We were a gang. We were a gang like we were on the first record. And it wasn't about the money. We all had so much money we couldn't spend it. It wasn't about the girls, because we all were in relationships, so we weren't out chasing girls. It wasn't about the drugs, because we'd quit doing the drugs and quit drinking, so it was only about the music.
And it was perfect, because it rained every single day. There was no, oh, it's nice out, let's go. No, we stayed in and we just worked. And we made a really, we made the best record of our career. It was just all about focus.
It was raw, we were a gang. We spent, you know, 8-12 hours in rehearsal. We hung out afterwards, we hung out before. It was a magical time.
You know, we're rock fans, so we like it. You know, we figure everyone else is gonna like it. But it was just, they're just better quality songs. The production's better on it. It was fun to have a lot of special guests come in. You know, like Steven Tyler sang on it, and Jack Blades, and Brian Adams, Robin Zander. You know, so it was kind of neat.
Kickstart My Heart lyrically, like a lot of our songs, just comes from experience, and I don't know where I came up with that title. But it came out. It just, I think I heard it somewhere in a movie or something, but I was playing guitar, I was in my kitchen on acoustic guitar, and I just started playing this thing, and I remember writing down on a napkin some of the lyrics, and my manager came over later that day, and he said, "What's that?" And I said, "It's this song called Kickstart My Heart." And he goes, what's it about? And I played it for him, and he goes, you have to show the band. And I said, I don't really know if it's quite right for us. And he goes, you're crazy. And I go, it's more of kind of a punk song that would be similar to our first album, and we're doing these big riffs with Sticky Sweet and Dr. Feelgood. And he got me to show it to the band.
Nikki had come to rehearsal with a few chords. And so we started like working on it and you know, adding parts and taking away parts, as we call it, like cutting the fat off the song.
If it wasn't for Tommy's rhythms, and back to Mick Mars, if it wasn't for the way Mick played guitar, it would just be a ratty punk rock song. It really took the three of us to make it into this big rock anthem, and with Vince's unique vocals is, you know, one of our biggest hits we've ever had.
One of my afterthoughts after the song was nearly done, I said, "Hey, what do you guys think about this?" And I went, bah, bah. You know, that introduction part, they were flipping out. Went, wow, that's really cool. I go, okay, we'll do that.
There was a struggle with management and with the record company where they wanted that to be the first single, and we wanted Dr. Feelgood to be the first single. The song almost like didn't have a shot, you know, it's like almost didn't show it to the band. Then the band didn't want it to be the first song. We thought maybe it would be a good third single or something. I don't think anybody really saw the importance of it. Everyone else saw the importance except for the band of that song.
What I try to do with my guitar, okay, when I do stuff like Kickstart My Heart, or I do stuff like Wild Side, or I do things like it's a little left field, is I try to innovate or show people that a guitar is more than just a six-string thing that you play. It's a real instrument. Look what you can do with this. I remember seeing Eric Clapton and B.B. King playing together. And so Eric Clapton gets up there and he goes, you know, his bass rips. And B.B. King looks up at him and he goes, bang! And the crowd just went, oh, they went nuts. And that's what I'm talking about. It's just like those simple little things like that that make a song a song.
You know, sometimes you look at your work, you look back at it and you go, it's all right. And then there's sometimes you look and you go, we nailed it. Like we knew that when we were done there, we nailed it. We knew we made an amazing record.
If you can go out of the arena and hum the solo or sing the solo, remember the solo, then you've done your job right, to me. I mean, that's the way I think about songs.
I don't think I'll ever forget having, I have it framed actually. We had a number one record in the country on my birthday. I'll never forget that. I remember the label calling, going, hey man, happy fucking birthday. You have a number one record in the country. And I was like, what? Didn't, totally unexpected. I knew we did well, and I knew it would do well, but not that.